ever-living God, in your tender love for the human race, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take upon him our nature and to suffer death upon the cross, giving us the example of his great humility. Mercifully grant that we may walk in the way of his suffering and also share in his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out my beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Rescue me from the hand of my enemies.
Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that it was in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Became like great drops of blood falling down on the ground. When he got up from prayer, he came to the disciples and found them sleeping because of grief. And he said to them,
"Why are you sleeping? Get up and pray that you may not come into the time of trial."
While he was still speaking, suddenly a crowd came, and the one called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He approached Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him,
"Judas, is it with a kiss that you are betraying the Son of Man?"
When those who were around him saw what was coming, they asked,
"Lord, should you strike him with the sword?"
And one of them struck the slave of the high priest and cut off his right ear. But Jesus said,
"No more of this."
And he touched his ear and healed him. Then Jesus said to the chief priests, the officers of the temple police, and the elders who had come for him,
"Have you come out with swords and clubs as if I were a bandit? When I was with you day after day in the temple, you did not lay hands on me. But this is your hour and the power of darkness."
Then they seized him and led him away, bringing him into the high priest's house. But Peter was following at a distance. When they had kindled a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them. Then a servant girl, seeing him in the firelight, stared at him and said,
"This man also was with him."
But he denied it, saying,
"Woman, I do not know him."
A little later, someone else, on seeing him, said,
"You also are one of them."
"Man, I am not."
Then, about an hour later still, another kept insisting,
"Surely this man also was with him, for he is a Galilean."
"Man, I do not know what you were talking about."
At that moment, while he was still speaking, the cock crowed. The Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me 3 times. And he went out and wept bitterly. Now the men who were holding Jesus began to mock him and beat him. They also blindfolded him and kept asking him,
"Prophesy, who is this that struck you?"
They kept heaping many other insults on him. When the day came, the assembly of the elders of the people, both chief priests and scribes, gathered together, and they brought him to their council. They said,
"If you are the Messiah, tell us."
"If I tell you, you will not believe. And if I question you, you will not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of God."
"Are you then the Son of God?"
"You say that I am."
"What further testimony do we need? We have heard it ourselves from his own lips."
Then the assembly rose as a body and brought him before Pilate. They began to accuse him, saying,
"We found this man perverting our nation, forbidding us to pay taxes to the emperor, and saying that he himself is the Messiah, a king."
"Are you the king of Jews?"
"You say so."
Then Pilate said to the chief priests and the crowds,
"I find no basis for an accusation against this man."
But they were insistent and said,
"He serves our people by teaching throughout all Judea, from Galilee, where he began to use his place."
Pilate was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him off to Herod, who was himself in Jerusalem at that time. When Herod saw Jesus, he was very glad, for he had been wanting to see him for a long time, because he had heard about him and was hoping to see him perform some sign. He questioned him at length, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the scribes stood by, vehemently accusing him. Even Herod with his soldiers treated him with contempt and mocked him. Then he put an elegant robe on him and sent him back to Pilate. That same day, Herod and Pilate became friends with each other. Before this, they had been enemies. Pilate then called together the chief priests, the leaders, and the people, and said to them,
"You brought me this man as one who was perverting the people. Here I have examined him in your presence, and have not found this man guilty of any of the charges against him, neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us. Indeed, he has nothing to deserve death. I will therefore have him flogged and release him."
Then they all shouted together,
"Away with this fellow! Release your rest for us."
This was a man who had been put in prison for an insurrection that had taken place in the city and for murder. Pilate, wanting to release Jesus, addressed them again, but they kept shouting,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
A third time he said to them,
"Why? What evil has he done? I have found him in no ground for the sentence of death. I will therefore have him flogged and then release him."
But they kept urgently demanding with loud shouts that he should be crucified, and their voices prevailed. So Pilate gave his verdict that their demand should be granted. He released the man they asked for, the one who had been put in prison for insurrection and murder, and he handed Jesus over as they wished. As they led him away, they seized a man, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming from the country, and they laid the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A great number of people followed him, and among them were women who were beating their breasts and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said,
"Daughters of Jerusalem, do not weep for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children. For the days are surely coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the barren, and the wombs that never bore, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will begin to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' Or if they do this when the wood is green, what will happen when it's dry?"
Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with him. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said,
"Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing."
And they cast lots to divide his clothing, and the people stood by watching. But the leaders scoffed at him, saying,
"He saved others, let him save himself. If he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one."
The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying,
"If you are a king of the Jews, save yourself."
There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying,
"Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us."
But the other rebuked him, saying,
"Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. This man has done nothing wrong. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom."
"Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise."
It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. While the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said,
"Father, into your hands I commend my spirit."
Having said this, he breathed his last. When the centurion saw what had taken place, he praised God and said,
"Certainly, this man was innocent."
When all the crowds who had gathered there for this spectacle saw what had taken place, they returned home, beating their breasts. But all his acquaintances, including the women who had followed him from Galilee, stood at a distance, watching these things. In her book, A Cloister Walk, Kathleen Norris relates a tale she had heard about a massacre that occurred in December of 1981, in a small village of El Mozote in El Salvador. Conflict happening there at the time. Most of the peasants killed were evangelical Christians, but the soldiers who were there remembered especially the death of one young girl. And I would invite you today to take this story and, in the way you can, stitch it into what this day is about and to maybe what's going on elsewhere in the world. There was one in particular the soldiers talked about that evening, a girl on La Cruz, whom they had raped many times during the course of the afternoon. And through it all, while the other women of El Mozote had screamed and cried, this girl had sung hymns, strange evangelical songs. And she kept right on singing, even after they had done what had to be done, and shot her in the chest. She had lain there on La Cruz with the blood flowing from her chest and had kept on singing, a bit weaker than before, but still singing. And the soldiers, stupefied, had watched and pointed. Then they had grown tired of the game and shot her again, and she sang still. And their wonder began to turn to fear, until finally they had unsheathed their machetes and hacked through her neck, and at last the singing stopped. One wonders, will this strange story of a powerless girl who had the power to make soldiers afraid be embellished over the years as the soldiers try to live with the horror they have done? This nameless girl has made her witness. It began when the soldiers' wonder began to turn to fear and continued as they argued afterwards about her death. Some declare that the girl's strange power proved that God existed And that brought them back to the killing of the children. There were a lot of differences among the soldiers about whether this had been a good thing or whether they shouldn't have done it. Sometimes it takes a death to make us see the obvious. Sometimes it is a fierce little girl who is hard to kill and who gives witness to a mystery beyond our understanding and control. And in the wild center of that young girl's heart, we glimpse a love stronger than death, a love that shames us all. Please stand for the prayers.
In this season of penitence and self-reflection, let us pray by saying, forgive our sins. For our church, this diocese, for Michael, our presiding bishop, for Morris, our bishop, and for Paul, our rector. Mercifully fill your people with the spirit of your unity.
Forgive our sins.
For this nation and all nations, especially those experiencing civil strife, establish among them that peace which is the fruit of righteousness.
Forgive our sins.
For our leaders, especially the President of the United States, the Governor of Louisiana, and all elected and appointed leaders, grant them the wisdom to promote the well-being of all people.
Forgive our sins.
For those who are ill and who are suffering from any infirmity, especially Rick, Helen, Beverly, Ron and Dean, Jody, Kitty, Carla, Jerry, Betsy, Lynn, Linda, Jan, and Rodney. Give your power of healing to those who minister to their needs.
Forgive our sins.
For all who have died in certain hope of the resurrection and eternal life, especially Karen, Augusta, Lucille, Harriet, Charles, Verna, and Charles, and for those who love them, grant that at our death we may enter with joy into your eternal kingdom.
Forgive our sins.
We give thanks for the presence in our blessings upon them in the coming year. Grant that they may grow in wisdom and grace.
Forgive us our sins.
Hear us, O Lord, for bounteous is your kindness and mercy. We earnestly implore your divine goodness.
Forgive us our sins.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, "Peace I give to you, my own peace I leave with you. Regard not our sins, but the faith of your church, and to give us that peace and unity of the heavenly city, where with the Father and the Holy Spirit you live and reign, now and forever.
Amen.
And the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome to all of you. It's great to see you today on this Palm Sunday as we begin our sort of pilgrimage through the next several days leading up to next Sunday. This is, you know, everything that we believe kind of hangs on this week, and so it's important for us to be present to this time. We do have a few announcements. One is that last week, Microsoft updated their operating system, and you need to keep up with that because they have security patches and whatnot. But what it did was break a program that we use for almost everything in the church, all right, for payroll, financials, database, all of that sort of thing. Lily and Pam had been working on that with a guy from Church Windows, and they were still working on it. Did it ever get resolved? No? Okay, so we're still kind of hanging out there with that. And then the little memory card that we use in the camera to record our services for YouTube has failed to function properly and won't work in the camera right now, so Lily brought her phone for us to do YouTube. So we're working on that, and hopefully can get it fixed by Easter. And last week, the church was hit by lightning. Was it something we said? I don't know. But anyway, it was hit by lightning and it knocked out a bunch of stuff, and some of it has been restored, but some of it hasn't been yet. So, all that's to say is we go into Holy Week, we do so kind of stove up, and if you need something from us, let us know, but we may not be able to get to it with the speed that we might otherwise do. Okay, it may take us a little bit longer. But whether the computer's working or not, Holy Week is still here. This week that is so important to us. And we have services this week almost every day. We have a Eucharist, and this kind of takes us back actually to our schedule pre-pandemic. We have a Eucharist tomorrow at 5 p.m. in this space, on Tuesday at 12 noon, on Wednesday at 10 a.m., and we'll also do the Wednesday Zoom service that we do on Wednesday. Thursday is Maundy Thursday. We will gather for worship at 7 p.m., and that service will include the stripping of the altar, which is so meaningful. And at the conclusion of the Maundy Thursday service, up until the beginning of the Good Friday service, we have our prayer vigil for the church and the world. And that's our opportunity to be still before the presence of God, to offer who we are and what we have and what we love to God, to be in prayer for ourselves, for our families, our friends, for this church and its mission, and for the many desperate things that are occurring in the world right now. This is our chance to just be available to God in the middle of all of this. And so if you would like to take part in that, I would invite you to sign up. The sign-up sheet is out in the narthex. We still have some spots that can be filled in. And we'll do that from the end of Maundy Thursday till the beginning of the Good Friday service. At Good Friday service begins at noon. The whole thing from end to end is 3 hours, but we do pieces. We do the Good Friday liturgy and then take silent prayer and then do the penitential order and take silent prayer, and that's kind of the rhythm of the day. Some people come for the whole time, and it really is transfiguring to do that, to just be still and be in prayer and not be sort of subject to the constant glare of things in the world. But some people's schedule won't allow it, so they come and then go, or they wait until later and come for part of it, and it's got that kind of come-and-go quality to it. So that begins at noon on Good Friday, and then on Easter Sunday, we have services at 8 a.m. and at 10:30 a.m. The thing that will be different on Easter is that the diocese has lifted its ban on the use of the chalice, so we will be able to resume having wine as part of the Eucharist. Now, on Easter Sunday, we use champagne. We use sparkling wine because of the sort of the symbolism that goes with that. It's light, it's bubbly, it's refreshing, it's new. Okay, so there's something going on here. But anyway, that will all start next Sunday. And we will receive communion as we usually do. If you're not comfortable receiving from the chalice, that's fine. I expect to have lots of folks that are not really comfortable. And if you're not, all you have to do is receive the bread and get up and go back to your seat. There's nothing else you need to do. You don't even cross your arms, cross your chest or anything. Just go back to your seat after you've received the bread. If you wish to receive the wine, you stay in place and the chalice will come to you. One of the things that we do, often do here, folks do, is intention, where you dip the bread in the wine. That is still prohibited. So we won't have intention. If you want the wine, you'll need to sip it from the chalice. But of course, it's precious metal, and it has alcohol in it. So there won't be much that can be communicated, except the presence of Jesus from sipping from the chalice. So, but that's totally your call. What we're saying is that we are just going to begin offering it come next Sunday, Easter Sunday. The following Sunday, Easter 2, we've got a couple of special things. One is that our young people are preparing a homiletical enterprise to speak the gospel to you on that day. And the other is that afternoon, Natalia will have her concert of classical music at 3 p.m., and that will be on April 24th. Once again, welcome to Palm Sunday. It's a delight to see you here, and I look forward to being with you as we go through these days to see what it is that God will show us and the way it is that God will work in us. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings. Take them into his courts. thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. For our sins he was lifted high upon the cross, that he might draw the whole world to himself. And by his suffering and death, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who put their trust in him. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ has risen.
Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctified by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray.
Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
pray you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and to give it into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.